your heart for this moment all week. So Lord, we come in this room and we are mindful that your presence is already here. Lord, anoint this worship team as they lead us into your presence. Anoint their singing, anoint their hearts, anoint this body at large for what you are doing, and cause our attention to be riveted upon you, and allow us, Lord, just to experience you this morning and receive from you exactly what it is that you have for us, that you've planned to give us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's begin to worship together.
Thank you. Majesty, all you are majesty. No. morning, thank you. This morning as we're singing, we're worshiping, I started to see the Holy Spirit coming and filling people up with oil. The Lord's showing me that, you know, if you know your Bible, there's a parable about the virgins. There are the 10 virgins. 5 of them ran out of oil. And they were pretty desperate to get this oil at the last minute. But as we go through life, we need to fill our lives with the oil of the Lord, which is the presence of the Lord. 200 times in the Bible, oil is tied to the presence of the Lord. And there are different kinds of oil. There's the oil of joy, the oil of gladness, the oil of healing, the oil that we put on people when we dedicate them to ministry to the Lord, and the oil that we, on Ephesians 6, our shield of faith. In the Roman days, they used to anoint that shield with oil because that shield was made of leather and it got dry. So the way they would fight is the soldiers would put oil over the shield. And that's the picture of faith. We need to have oil on our shield of faith. And why? Because they'd hold up their shields and then the arrows would slide off. And the flaming arrows wouldn't be able to penetrate. So what I'm seeing this morning, I see a lot of people needing oil. Every one of us needs to keep our oil level up. And there are so many different ways that we need oil. Some of you need oil for your marriage. It's creaking a bit, like a creaky door. You need oil in that relationship, the smoothing in that relationship. I want you to think about that for your marriage this morning. Because the enemy loves to come in when there are divisions in relationships. Maybe even in a friendship. Some of you this morning are weary and tired. And you're like on the rim of your rubber tires of going off and you're just saying, I need some help here. Life's getting tough. Some of you this morning want oil for the anointing to minister to other people. We should be filled up with the oil and burning with the Spirit, so much so that that oil flows all over us and all down over us. Like in the says over Aaron's beard, and it flows to others. When they touch us, they touch the oil. The oil is the anointing oil. When you see someone with the anointing, they've been in the oil. The presence of the Lord and the oil are synonymous. So I want you just to not come forward. Make a cup with your hands. And this just, I want to pray. If you've got a spouse, I want you to stand next to them and get it together. You might need to talk to them as you're doing this. So right now I'm going to ask the Lord just to release things. Thank you, Jesus. Right now, pour oil over your people this morning. Lord, I just ask you to release the oil of joy. The oil of joy over the sadness and the oppression that people have walked in. I bind that oppression and I release the oil of joy and the oil of gladness. Lord, I just pray for an oil this morning to come upon relationships. I release that oil. It says it, the oil poured down on Aaron's beard and it was tied into unity. I release the oil that heals relationships this morning. I ask you, Lord, to minister to couples this morning. Whether like saying, no, we got problems. I had a message on my phone. First thing, pray for my marriage. There's nobody in the room sent that. So we lift up those marriages where the enemy has come and he's buffeted and he's trying to break it. And I declare and decree this morning that what God has put together, no man should put asunder. We say that when we do a wedding. And I bind a spirit of divorce that I see in the spirit this morning. I say no. And Lord, I ask you, Lord, for healing to come. Lord, we send healing over the internet. John, Brother John, Lord, to others who are home and they need healing. And you can heal even at a distance, like a centurion. Say the word and they'll be healed. We release the word of healing in this house. Just receive it right now by faith. I receive the healing of the Lord. And I just release also a healing for those that are emotionally struggling. They got problems. They even talk about those problems. And Lord, I just pray you would anoint their mouth with oil. They begin to speak the word. They begin to speak faith. They would stop grumbling, complaining. They stop the negativity. They begin to say what you're saying about every situation. Thanks be to Christ, who always causes us to triumph. So this morning as we worship, Lord, let that oil just flow. Just flow in this house. Flow in this house. If you really want like a hand laid on you, I don't want everybody running up, but just come up. We'll lay a hand on you if you need that. Just come on up here. Some people, they need that. Thank you, Jesus.
Rest on your life right now.
yourself right here. You're doing so much in this room. Lord, we embrace you. We embrace your presence. We embrace your healing. We embrace your infilling. We embrace your anointing today. Lord, you're equipping each person in this room that is ready and open to receive for what is about to happen in their life. And Lord, right now, I claim that in Jesus' name. Praise God. Do you enjoy the presence of the Lord? I want to make some observations if I can, or make some comments that might help us in the journey. How many know that when we gather together as a corporate body like we do Sunday morning here in the service, we touch the presence of God, but we live life through the course of the week. And we have a church family, and the church family is actively involved. Actually, after the service here this morning, there is a lot of other things that are going to be happening in the life of this family. And that goes tonight, tomorrow night. Look at your program. You'll see there are so many different things that are going to be happening to enhance the life and fellowship of this house so that we're growing. And I want to bring you up to speed on some of what that looks like. Earlier this week, the elders of our church met, and it was their consensus to recognize that Ben is the guy to help transition from the young generation into the culture of this church, the presence of God. And so we're so excited to announce that Ben is going to be overseeing youth and young adults for the next season. He's going to also be applying himself to Bible college in a few weeks, and there's going to be commuting from here to Portland and back and forth, just being equipped and trained. He's going to be a busy boy, but nonetheless, we're really pleased that God has one amongst us that will be serving in that respect. Here's our concerns over the years that we raise up a generation. Now, hear me carefully. We raise up a generation of young people that will carry the culture of this church. We identify the culture of our church is one that we seek earnestly the presence of God. And that is what we endeavor to do. And so if you've got young people, and you know young people, and you're praying for young people, that Jesus is the only answer for their life, how many know, and that's so true, we want to encourage you to be involved in supporting the youth ministries of this house. So Ben's going to come, and he's going to tell us a little bit about tonight and what's going to happen as we get started in this journey. And then he's going to say a little bit about our young adults. He'll identify that group as well and tell you a little about that vision.
Yeah. First of all, I think that Pastor Larry's spot on when he talks about how important it is for this next generation to carry the culture and the heart of what's being built here. I listened to a sermon a few weeks ago about this next generation not fighting the same battles that those before them fought. We don't need to reset. We need to build on the building blocks that have been set. We have amazing leaders in this house who have they've slain some giants, and there's no reason for us to fight the same giants. We need to build upon that and not reset. So talking about tonight, we have a youth group. I believe it's at 6 o'clock. It's in the bulletin. Someone can confirm that for me. But yeah, we have youth group at 6 o'clock tonight, which is fantastic. We're getting together right now and building a relationship with these kids and starting to help them become friends with each other, because it's so important to surround yourself in a good friend group. And as we start transitioning into teaching them more about what it means to be a part of the culture that we've set here, it begins with having peers that are like-minded and wanting to go the same direction as you. And so we're having a bit of a game night tonight. It should be a fun time. We'll see if anyone can beat me in ping pong like Daniela did last time, unfortunately. But yeah, it'll be a really good time. And yeah, I think it's at 6 o'clock. Again, check the bulletin. It's 6 or 6:30. I can't remember what we settled on, to be honest with you. But and then the other thing is, on Friday night, we're going to be meeting with the young adults. The dwelling place is back. We took a few weeks off, but we'll be coming back together. And those times are just so sweet, because we're able to get people who are so willing to surrender everything to the Father. And he shows up in such a mighty way. It's really special. That'll be at 7 o'clock, ages 16 to 30, or it's a little fluid around the 30 end if you want to come and you're older than 30. Just come and talk to me, and we can get that all squared away. But yeah.
Okay, well, we need to set tonight. I don't know if you'll find a time, so let's set it right now. 6 o'clock is the time we're going to meet this evening for you and the age group. You didn't tell us, Ben, so let's go.
My bad. It's anywhere from 6th grade through high school, so 6th to 12th grade, anywhere in that regard.
Okay, good. So that's going to be exciting. If you know young people in that age bracket, feel free to encourage them to be a part of this. This is going to be amazing, the journey that these kids are going to find, and it's going to take in a lot of different factors. Teaching, it's going to take in retreats, conferences, it'll take in all kinds of things to be immersed in the presence of Jesus. And so we get started here this evening. So note that. Take care of that. Take note of that. Throughout this week, I just want you to know, prayer tomorrow night, and then we go through the week with our women's and men's events. I want to say that next Sunday morning, it's going to be an epic service with Joel Chukes. Joel will be preaching and ministering, so I want you to come. Prepare your heart early so that you can receive the fullness of what God has for you. I do need to say that in the month of November, we've got a number of things that are going to be exceptional. Not only is Joel going to be starting the month off, but then on the 19th of November, I want you to note that Sunday. That's the Sunday that precedes Thanksgiving. We are going to blend the Hispanic and English service right here at 10:30. Then that's going to be real special. I'm going to be preaching. Simone's going to be translating. And everything is going from A to Z. It's going to be a service to host the Hispanic and the English element of our church. I don't know if you know this, upwards to 40 people meet in the fireside room early in the Sunday morning. When you're just getting ready to get here, they're having a wonderful time of worship. Simone's doing an amazing job with those people, and it's going to be a blending time. Following that service, Debbie, it's her idea, I support it. We're going to have soup and rolls, and it's going to be a morning of fellowship where we'll be able to integrate with people that we don't always see and visit with on Sunday. So it's going to be a wonderful mixing time together. You need to know that's on the 19th. And then 7 days later, the 26th, that's the Sunday after Thanksgiving. You tracking with me? Okay, on that Sunday, we're going to have Merrily Dawn. The Merrily Dawn has been in this church several times over the years. Merrily Dawn has a national ministry. She's been on Daystar. She's been on TBN, known largely for her puppet ministry, children's ministries, but she's also been a women's conference speaker, and she will touch you women and challenge you into the things of God like you've never been in a long while. So we're going to encourage you to be prepared. That's the Sunday after Thanksgiving Day proper. So before Thanksgiving, we have the blended service. After Thanksgiving, we have a special service. So I want you to know we've got some amazing things planned for the month of November, and we're believing God for some awesome things to happen. I want to encourage you to continue to give to the work and ministry of this church as we embrace the vision and the overhead that it takes to do that. You can do that by supporting in your tithes, your offerings. And then I'm going to say that also you're going to see in the month of November opportunity to give to the children of Rescue Ministries International and the Bridge of Love. We're going to be putting a little Christmas tree out in the hallway. It's going to have names of children, and you're going to be able to support and bless those kids for the celebration of Christmas. So we'll say more about that as the season unfolds. And so you can give in these manners to Cornerstone Church. You see there will be, if you go online, our connections to the different ministries that we endorse and support. And then, of course, your tithing and your giving is greatly appreciated. I want you to take your Bibles right now. We're going to turn to Scripture, and I want to share with you the message for this morning. And I want to talk to you about a very relevant subject and how we can deal with the subject of fear and actually disarming fear in our lives. And I want you to take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 20. And I'm going to do my very, very best to try to convince you this morning that Jesus' presence is your power to disarm any fear you have or will have in your life. Did you hear what I just said? The presence of Jesus is your answer to fear. And I'm going to talk to you about what fear looks like in your life. You might be sitting here today and saying, well, I'm not overcome by fear. Maybe, maybe not. So take a look at John chapter 20 and look at verse number 19. I'm going to read out of the English Standard Version. And here's what the scripture says in this account. On the evening of that day. What day? The day that the disciples gathered after Jesus was crucified. And I want you to notice something about this gathering. On that day, it happened to be the Lord's Day. And it happened to be on the evening of the Lord's Day. Let me put that into the frame of reference that you can understand. That would be Sunday night. Okay. A Sunday night after Jesus was crucified, he rose from the grave, the disciples gathered. So let me start again. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked, that's a clue. Why do you lock doors? You're afraid somebody's going to break in. They're not welcome. So to ensure the fact that they're not welcome, you're going to lock your doors, right? That's what you do. So the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Clue number two. This is what they were walking in, was the fear of the Jews. And Jesus came. Where did he come from? How did he get in? The doors were locked. Figure it out. How many know there was a post-resurrection miracle going on here? Jesus appeared through the walls, came into the house where they were gathered together. This is after Jesus had been crucified. He rose from the grave. They locked all the doors. And he stands in the midst of them, and he says, "Peace be with you." Wow. And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Why would he do that? Well, he came in a rather unorthodox way, and to be sure that it was him coming in, he had to show evidence to them that this is the very same one that they knew. Then, it says, the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you." The word that we're so commonly familiar with is fear, and it comes from the Greek deity, Phobos. This Greek god, the role of this Greek god, Phobos, was to inspire fear into people. And I want you to know that at the heart of fear is a spiritual war or battle. That's the heart of fear. It's a spiritual battle. You might think it's an emotional thing, and you can touch your emotions, but at the heart of it, you're dealing with a spiritual battle, a war. The word phobia could have 1,000 different applications and prefixes. For instance, there's acrophobia, which means fear of heights. Agoraphobia means the fear of open spaces or crowds. And then there's the opposite, claustrophobia. Here are some more. Anthrophobia, aquaphobia, astrophobia. There's even a fear of gold, if you can imagine. Aurophobia. And these are barely scratching the surface of the phobias that start with the letter A. How many know there's a ton of other letters in our alphabet? So you can get overcome with fear very easily. Why? Because we live in a world consumed by fear. And we do so because we live without Jesus. That's the deal. We even conjure up ways to instill fear in our own lives. How stupid is that? You say, "How do we do that, Pastor?" Well, I'll tell you how we do it, like Halloween stuff. And I want to encourage you to rethink your participation in Halloween this year, right now. You see, the absence of Jesus means fear. I want you to get that in your thinking this morning. And fear can be paralyzing. So let's just take a look at these disciples for a minute. They were hiding behind locked doors and shaking in their sandals. They're terrified in the aftermath of Jesus' death. The Bible says they feared the Jews. So which Jews were they fearing? Because most of that group in and of itself were Jews in the room. In that day, it was probably more common to fear the Romans. But I submit to you, the disciples weren't necessarily afraid of the Jews proper or even the Romans. They were demonstrating their fear of the Jewish religious system, which included the leaders of the Jews. They had just witnessed the side of this Jewish system that exercised their power, and if they could kill one of them, they could kill those that were following Jesus. So maybe they were planning, in this case, the Jewish leaders to kill more disciples, and that's what these disciples seem to be afraid of. And in the face of the unknown, these disciples should have, could have been good to be drawing upon God's strength. But like us, they were very human. And when push came to shove, they found themselves extremely full of fear. Their fear froze their capacity to trust by faith. And it distorted their view of the future. I ask you, does that sound familiar? The Bible says in this account, then suddenly Jesus came. He came. And when he came, the first words out of his mouth were, "Peace be with you." I want you to notice something. He did not admonish them for their fearful state. He didn't beat them up. He didn't scold them. He didn't chastise them for their disbelief. He didn't do any of that. Jesus simply spoke encouragement into their deepest need at that moment. The Bible says, so stretching out his hands, revealing his pierced side, he spoke of the fact that Jesus was with them. And the Bible says this, the response to that, they were glad. Do you know why they were glad? Because fear was gone. Jesus entered the room, a room filled with fear, but once he entered the room, fear is gone. I want you to get it in your mind, when you're in the presence of Jesus, fear has to go. But if you trust in a whole lot of other things and don't let go of your fear, it's going to be a problem. Jesus was intersecting their point of fear as he stood in the room, showed with full evidence who he was, and spoke the words of peace. And I want you to picture the flood of relief that comes when they recognize this figure with them, and he was Jesus in person. They could have said, hey, is this really you? Or some other thing. But I want you to know, when Jesus' presence came into the room, it changed everything. And it's the same way for us today. To our fearful hearts, Jesus' presence and peace are still the answer, as it was in this moment in time. I think it's the heart of God, because it's evidenced in this particular passage of Scripture, that God is tender toward our proneness to fear. He understands our inclination to walk by sight and not by faith. He understands that. You see, in Psalms chapter 103, verse 14, it says, God knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. And so he's compassionate toward us. Let me illustrate this point if I can. If you are a parent, and most of you are today, imagine coming home and finding one of your children in a most vulnerable moment. You see your four-year-old, picture this, weeping on his bed, and you rush over to comfort your little four-year-old. You ask, what's wrong? And he says, Mommy, Daddy, what are we going to eat today? Where are we going to live? Who's going to take care of us? I'm sure that you as a parent would be far removed from anger or annoyance in that moment. I don't think you would say, hey, come on, let's go into the woodshed and you're going to get whipped for this. I'm sure you as a parent would find that your heart would be grieved to see your child in such a fearful state of anxiety. And I want to say that in light of how God views us when we're walking through our times of humanness and fear. How much of our emotional health do we willingly give over to fear? And you need to know the Lord knows your every need. He provides for the birds. And aren't you of more value than they? He clothes, the Bible says, the flowers, and will he much more clothe you? Scripture says there, O ye of little faith. God's concerned about the conditions of our heart. This morning as we process life and we walk through the different forms of fear that we face, I wanna bring this very clearly to you, that Jesus' presence removes fear. And if you're walking in some kind of fear today, you need to ask yourself some real clear questions. What's preventing me from trusting, abiding, connecting, embracing Jesus in the fullest measure? You're never farther from his desire for you when your heart is filled with anxious fear. So what needs to be our game plan? I want to give you quickly some of these, and then I'm going to encourage David to come, who has an encouraging word on abiding. I want him to give that to you this morning as we wrap up our time. But I want to share with you what might need to be our game plan. I want to offer some things for you this morning to stay the course of faith and avoid fear. Can I get a confession out of you this morning? How many, like me, have hints of fear encroach your life? Well, here we go. I'm going to give you some things that I've kind of learned in the process. Number one, realize the answer to fear is Jesus' peace. These do not co-mingle. You don't have the peace of God and fear in the same chair, all right? That doesn't happen. Number two, access to peace is Jesus. So firstly, realize that the answer to fear is peace. But accessing that peace, you need to be clear on this, is the person of Jesus. But I want you to know, proximity by itself doesn't equal provision. Did you get that? Proximity by itself doesn't equal provision. Number three, you must draw on God's strength. You have to welcome the strength of God into your life. You can scan the horizon of your future, and if you're fearful about anything, you can now just step in and draw from God and what His provision might be. You draw on God's strength. You've got to draw on His strength. Number four, let Jesus speak peace to you. I give you those four things as action steps to embracing and Jesus and taking steps to eliminate the fear element. Jesus is every bit as much in the room with you as He was with the disciples. When you embrace Him. So the bottom line is this: only Jesus can disarm your fear, and He'll replace it with His peace. I want David to come and talk to us a little bit about abiding this morning and how that factors into where we need to walk as a people.
Thank you, Pastor. During worship, the Lord began to just drop into my heart. Jesus talked in John about He is the true vine and we are the branches. And He said that everyone that abides in Him bears much fruit. And the fruit that is born brings glory to the Father. He said, apart from me, you can do nothing. That word abide means to be deeply rooted, deeply connected. And Jesus prayed His priestly prayer in John 17, that Father, that the ones that believe in me, my followers, that they would be one as you and I are one. That the world may know that you have sent the Son. And so the heart of God is that we be so one with Him. That same oneness, that same intimacy that the Son and the Father had and have and continue to have. That abiding speaks of, Paul said, I have been crucified. The life I now live, I live by faith in Jesus Christ, who loved me and gave his life for me. And I believe the Lord just wants to give a gentle urge today. Paul says to examine ourselves to see if we still be in the faith. And Jesus wants us to examine our oneness with him. He says, I've given you one life. You only have one life. How are we living this life? Jesus went on to say that a person's life does not consist of the things he possesses in Luke chapter 12. Our job, our home, our cars, our status do not define who we are. These are earthly things, transitory things. Yes, he blesses us. He blesses his people. But that doesn't define who you are. He said, seek rather to be rich in your relationship with your heavenly Father. That defines who we are. We believe and we seek the manifest power of God, right? We want to see what Jesus said, those who believe my name, these signs shall follow. That's part of the authentic gospel. However, in Matthew 7, Jesus addressed a situation. You prophesied in my name. You did miracles in my name. You cast out demons in my name. And you called me Lord. But he says, depart from me. I never knew you. How can that be? I have some theories, but I'm not going to get into it right now. But the issue is, it says, I never knew you. Jesus showed us how to live. His eyes and his ears were connected with the Father. He said, I did nothing except I saw the Father do the works. I spoke nothing except I heard the Father speak the words. He said, the works that I do are the Father working through me. And so I think what the Lord wants to remind us today, it's not about the works. It's not only about the signs and wonders. It's being connected to him, knowing him, and letting him live his life through us. And that requires intimacy. That requires a change in our schedules. That requires a change in our priorities. The things of this world are passing away. There's only one thing that's going to remain, and that's his kingdom. Now, I don't understand eschatology, but I do understand one thing. If you want to get a glimpse of God's timetable, where we are, focus on what's going on in the nation of Israel. We're getting close, family. This move of God that is sweeping the earth, it may be the last move of God before the rapture of the church. Time is short. Time is short. And Jesus said, let me live through you. Let me speak through you. Begin to reassess our lives. Am I living my life to the fullness for the kingdom of God? Am I truly stepping aside and giving room for Jesus? Am I crucifying myself every day and living my life by faith in him? Am I examining my life? Am I still living in the faith? Jesus said, did you do the things I asked you to do? It's different for each one of us. But that's the bottom line. Are you doing what I've asked you to do? And it starts with intimacy and time with him. Peter was so intimate with the Lord. It said that when he passed by people, his very shadow healed people. He was so one in the presence of God. Kind of sounds like Psalm 91, in the shadow of the Almighty. And so I just feel the Lord wants to encourage us today, remind us today, how are we living our life? How are we spending our time? Are we truly seeking to abide in Him, rooted, deeply rooted and grounded in Him?
Well, Dave, you said a lot in that short span, but here's what I want to say related to that. Abiding in Jesus is going to affect your productivity on the planet, right? Hey, listen carefully. Abiding in Jesus is going to affect how productive we're going to be. But at the same time, in relation to what I just shared with you, abiding in Jesus is going to settle the issue of how you walk your life in fear or faith. Good word, Dave. There are consequences to our choices. This morning, I want to pray for you that your life would be full of faith. And when you abide in Jesus, His peace comes to you. And what happens to fear? All those phobias, which in fact I said at the start of this message, was the enemy's plot to overthrow you in a spiritual war. But when you embrace the presence of Jesus, He supplants the enemy. And He gives to you faith. He gives to you peace. And you can live your life fully, day by day, in peace. Stand to your feet with me, would you please? Would you lift your hands? That's a visible sign of not only surrender, but receiving. Let your hands, your outstretched arms, be your antennas today to the message of hope that Jesus has for you. Lord, we stand in this room, all of us, look at this place, Lord Jesus, full of people lifting their hands to you, just simply saying, Lord, I want to receive hope from you. I want to disarm fear in my life. I realize that to do so, I need to embrace you. I need to receive you with for who you are. The prints of the nails in your hands, the riven side. And I'm intentionally abiding in you today. And as I do that, in this troubled world, I have nothing to fear because my trust is in you. My anchor is in you. And as we look all around us, the chaos in our governmental systems, the economies of this world, what is taking place in the Middle East and other places, Lord, that's easy to set us up for fear. But Lord, we're trusting you because you have all things in perfect control. Even our life. Even where the rent, the house payments coming from this month. You've got that covered. And we trust you. We trust you for our next breath. We trust you with our families. We trust you. Impeccably today. And we receive your peace now in Jesus' name. Amen. Can I encourage you this morning to live that way tomorrow, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday? Next Sunday, I want to talk to you about worship, what that looks like, and how God wants us to be worshipers. Then we get to hear Joel Chooks. Let me rephrase that. Joel Chooks next Sunday, worship after that. How's that? Okay? Just getting ahead of myself a little bit. But we're going to We're not going to take a step backwards. We're going to keep pressing forward. Amen. And believing God for what he has. If you wish to have further prayer, come. We have a great worship team, great prayer team that just love to see you advance in the ways of God. If you must go, God bless you. Have a powerful, powerful week. And for goodness sakes, don't walk in fear. Amen? Come on, give the Lord an applaud together. You're dismissed.